Please close your eyes. Take a deep breath. Still the mind. And think with your heart. Think about the first time you fell in love. About the last time you were truly happy. About someone very meaningful to you and the love you share with each other. Please open your eyes. Now, perhaps it was rather unexpected of me to ask you to think with the heart, for we all know that the brain is the organ that controls our thought processes. Yet, when we think of the heart, we link it with emotion, with love, with passion. While the scientific function of the heart has been identified, the heart as a metaphor, as a certain way of thinking, especially existentially, has endured throughout history. Interestingly, these metaphors for the heart modify within different cultures. Growing up, I was exposed to an idea common within Hinduism that the heart is a home for the soul. While this idea differs from what I experience here in the US, there is a shared commonality between the two. And that is that metaphors for the heart are incredibly powerful. So much so that they have medical implications. They influence the way we perceive our bodies, and they inform the way we make decisions regarding our health and our heart health. This is especially important for South Asians, who bear the highest global burden of heart disease. In both the US and the UK, South Asians bear the highest rate of heart disease among any ethnic groups within those countries. In 2010, the American Heart Association issued a call to action, striving to reach this population in the US and prevent heart disease. In 2010, at the same time, I had already developed a sincere fascination for the heart. I had spent some time volunteering in a free hypertension clinic within the city and conducted a little bit of cardiac research. Yet, being a South Asian immigrant myself, I could understand how different cosmologies inform different beliefs and perceptions about the heart within different cultures. Yet, this also made me aware of a potential dilemma. As a current medical student, we view the heart as a very complex physiological pump. How then am I to reconcile this idea with the notion that the heart may have some deeper existential functioning, such as serving as the home for the soul? And if I have a patient who believes his or her heart is the home for the soul, and that patient needs a heart transplant, how do I reconcile this belief with medical necessity? In a desire to understand this subject further, I undertook a program of research. As a student of medical anthropology in the UK, I sought to understand the different factors that lead to one's understanding of the heart, whether religious, social, cultural, any factor of one's enworldment. And there I sought to ask two questions. One, how do we view our bodies, a study of embodiment? And two, how do we take life experiences and internalize them within the body, a study of phenomenology? Amongst those that I interviewed in the UK, I discovered three common themes. One, that the heart is believed to be the home for the soul, and the heart is an emotional reservoir generating emotions. Two, that the heart has a brain of its own involved in decision-making. And three, that traumatic life experiences become internalized within the body through the heart, creating a link between cultural phenomena and somatic bodily experiences. Yet, at the end of the day, this discussion is not about what the true scientific understanding is of the heart. It is coming to appreciate that different metaphors for the heart exist and are real, for they have real implications within medicine. Perhaps one of the most intriguing aspects I discovered was that the heart is believed to be an emotional reservoir, generating emotions. That emotions originate from the heart and are sent to the brain in order to be activated. So, say for example, you experience happiness. Happiness originates from the heart, is sent to the brain, and the brain then tells your body to sing or dance and act accordingly. However, this relationship between the heart and the brain is not so simple. Many of my informants believed that the superior capabilities of the heart were due to a mini brain located within the heart, termed a heart brain. This heart brain would send electrical activity upwards to the brain, controlling decisions and controlling our thought processes. The idea that the heart has a mastery over the brain dates back thousands of years to Ayurvedic medicine, the ancient medical system within India, which says that both the mind and the self are located within the heart. Yet perhaps even more interesting than this was the idea that the soul resides within the heart. In Hinduism, the soul is considered to be ubiquitous, formless, indestructible, and unchanging. It is believed to be the all-pervading aspect of God. A famous English translation of the Bhagavad Gita, a sacred Hindu text, says that the Supreme Lord is situated within the heart of all beings. In Hindu philosophy, there are two selves. One self is the doer, often called the ego. The other self is the knower, often called the divine soul. In order for us to realize our true identity as a divine soul, we must surrender the ego. If we do not, we get caught in this illusion that our identity is the body rather than the soul. Simply put, if one is able to shed the ego, we will understand our true identity as a divine soul. And this soul will radiate the same light of God within us. This idea is perhaps the cornerstone of understanding the significance of the heart within this population. For it is the heart that connects one soul to another. Many of my informants believed in the idea of reincarnation, that souls travel with us throughout numerous births, carrying with it imprints and memories from previous lifetimes. These memories can be reawakened whenever we come in contact with a familiar soul. These memories then allow for us to communicate with another soul through a subconscious mechanism. Many of my informants believed that this mechanism is given power because the heart has an electromagnetic sphere of its own. This electromagnetic spectrum allows for one to attract another soul or repel another soul. In essence, it allows for a subconscious communication that does not require speaking. Many of my informants also believed that the heart and soul are able to guide one's character. The heart is believed to hold a memory cache in which previous experiences and memories from lifetimes are stored within this portion of the heart. This memory cache then sends memories and influences the brain in its thought-making process. When it does so, it's able to influence our consciousness, and throughout many number of years, is able to mold and shape our character. Yet, what I found very interesting amongst those I interviewed was that even if the heart undergoes any sort of physiological trauma, such as a reduction in blood flow or a heart attack, these unique functions of the heart and of the soul remain unharmed. Because my informants believed that these functions were attributed to the soul, and the soul is impervious to any physical harm. It is indestructible. Along the same line of reasoning, because we are never the true owners of the body, we are the soul, and our body is transient. Let's think of reincarnation as if you were buying a new cell phone. When you buy a new cell phone, you take the SIM card out of the old cell phone and place it into the new one, because it has stored the previous contacts and phone numbers. We can think of the soul as a SIM card for the body, that when we are born, the soul enters the body. When we leave, the soul leaves the body. And when we are born again, that same soul re-enters the body, bringing with it the stored memories and life experiences with it. Thus, because we are not the true owners of the body, only the temporary inhabitants of it, what does this mean for organ donation? When I asked those that I interviewed, they were strongly in support of organ donation. The medical anthropologist Svenaeus describes that when we see somebody else in pain, we are connected to that individual by our very shared togetherness in this world. While we do not experience that person's pain, we feel with one another. Thus, my informants believed, if there is anything you can do to alleviate that person's suffering, it is not only a good thing to do, it is in fact your duty. Thus, my informants were strongly in favor of organ donation. But then I asked, what about heart transplants? And what happens to the soul in a heart transplant? The next image is a real medical image. Surprisingly, my informants believed that during a heart transplant, the soul leaves the heart and spreads itself throughout the body. The old heart is taken out, a new heart is placed in, and the soul then goes from the body back into its rightful place within the heart, restoring its normal functions, controlling blood flow, regulating emotional output, and controlling and shaping our character. Perhaps one of the most intriguing aspects I discovered throughout this process was understanding how the heart is able to catalog phenomenological experiences of life events. The medical anthropologist Sordis describes that the body is the existential ground of culture and self, that the body becomes lived through life experiences. I believe the heart is not only a component of this lived body, but that the heart also becomes lived through life experiences. This lived heart links experience with being, so much so, as Gant says, that the heart has a psychiatric life and history of its own. I would like to tell you about one of my informants, Mrs. Nagra. Mrs. Nagra confided to me one day that she was often experiencing heart palpitations. She said she was becoming increasingly worried about her husband's increasing health and growing number of health concerns. She said she often felt a pressure build up behind her heart, so much so that when she couldn't contain it anymore, the energy would burst forth, pervading her entire body, resulting in heart palpitations. What does this experience tell us about the heart? It reveals to us that everyday life experiences become internalized within the body through the heart, creating a link between cultural phenomena and somatic bodily experiences. Now, while we have been discussing the heart as a metaphor within the body, we must also look at the heart as a metaphor within medicine. True healthcare has to keep the person in mind. It has to create value for the end user, the patient. I believe we must look at a patient's enworldment, the myriad factors leading to one's understanding and perception of the heart and of the body. While medicines may treat a person's underlying physiology, true healing goes one step beyond. It seeks to reconcile the differing metaphors and beliefs we have about the heart and of the body, allowing us to create meaningful connections between others, such as building a meaningful relationship between the doctor and the patient. In the same way that many factors contribute to our understanding of the body, many factors also shape the field of medicine as a whole. I believe we must not look at medicine as a stagnant entity, but rather as a dialogue communicating amongst many spheres of influence, such as religion, politics, economics, social beliefs, and others. When we do so, we open the doors to view medicine within its interdisciplinary sphere, and we allow for individuals to unite together and work collectively to solve some of the most persistent problems that we face in healthcare today, such as heart disease. Thank you.